Hello everybody, welcome to another K2 webinar. My name is Kyron Murphy, I'm working with K2 here in Rain. Today we have something special for you. We're discussing tile roofs and some of the more detailed intricacies of building on tile roofs. Today I'm joined with Marcel Wolfling from, maybe you can introduce yourself for a moment.
Hey guys, my name is Marcel Wölfling. I'm from Rapid Bitron Diamanttechnik. And I'm here to show you a little tool of us called Tile and Gutter Support Milling Machine.
Yeah, thanks for that. So if you haven't joined us before, it'll be a little similar. I'll go through the whole program actually, and we'll discuss some of the products we have, some of the details of what you need to do on a tile roof, what is more important or what is important to know. We'll then be showing off our products, which we have some samples here, and then I'll be handing over to a colleague of mine, Roman Bile, and he'll be doing a bit of a demonstration of our software and some of the information we have online. I'd like to introduce him now as well. Roman, are you there? Can you hear us?
Hey everyone, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can. Yeah.
Sure, wait a second, there is the camera. Hey everyone, nice to see you again. My name is Roman, I'm also working in the technical department, same as Kyron does. Glad to see you back here. For those of you who haven't been here, I'm doing the online part, I'm helping out with questions, and yeah, I'm just the assistant of Kyron, and today also of Marcel. So have fun, everyone. Just a little thing from my side again. There's a Q&A button at the bottom. Please use this one if you have any questions. We are happy to help out and answer the questions. We're jumping forth and back. Kyron and I will answer and ask questions, and Marcel's involved as well this time. So thank you for being here.
Yeah, thanks, Roman. Yeah, just to recap what we're going to do, we'll be discussing tiles in a lot more detail than we have in previous webinars. So if you have joined before, hopefully there'll be some new information for you. Marcel will be going through his product, and I'll actually be giving a little demonstration on how it works and the benefits of that. Marcel, maybe you could just pop out the way. I'll then be going through some of our products. Thanks for that. Give you a great idea of what we have, how they work. And then Roman will be going through the online part. We'll then have a time for some Q&A. And this is an opportunity, if you have any questions that have come up throughout the webinar, you're able to turn on the microphone and ask either myself or Roman directly. However, if you do have any questions throughout that you don't want to turn your microphone on for, you can ask them in the Q&A function. So Roman mentioned that before, but the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen, and not the chat function. So we'll get back to you shortly when you ask those questions. So Marcel, you can jump back in. Sorry for pushing you out before. So just quickly, tile roofs, what is important? So probably the biggest point or biggest issue that people installing solar on tile roofs face are the tiles themselves. So the details of the tile, the information, how they fit together, how the roof hooks fit within these tiles can be probably the most difficult part or the most tedious part of installing solar PV on tile roofs. And today we're going to focus on the tiles a little bit. How do we work the tiles to ensure the roof hooks fit? How do we pick the right roof hook based on the tile we have? And we'll also be discussing a little bit more information on perhaps the batten spacing and the physical details of roof installation. So the standard process for installing a tile, a PV on a tile roof, is to use a bit of an angle grinder. And we have a bit of we did a demonstration yesterday and we took some photos, and we'd just like to show some of them with you now. We have a little PowerPoint, which you can hopefully all see now. And so, unfortunately, this is something we have to do for all tile roofs. The tiles are designed to fit together, which means that if you want to put something between them, you have to do a bit of work to...
just swipe links. Which screen are you sharing?
Sorry guys, we're sharing screen two at the moment, and then
no, screen one.
Screen one.
Screen sharing again.
And this one.
No, which on the screen sharing on Zoom.
On Zoom, we're sharing the PowerPoint.
Screen one.
Oh, rather than the.
Yes.
Is it better?
Yeah.
Sorry for that, everybody. The PowerPoint is still working now, guys. Tom.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect. So. Yeah. So apologies for that. So we have to work the tile to ensure the roof hooks can fit in. And this is usually done with an angle grinder. And the process is effectively, it's quite quick. However, it is quite tedious. So we have to measure the distance between or where we need to cut out. This is done with the roof hooks, so depending on the width of the roof hook that you have, it's probably 30 or 35 millimeters or thereabouts, but this is specific for the roof hooks. This needs to be marked out onto the tile. The angle grinder is then used to cut out a few sort of small inlays or divots, and then this can be worked away with the angle grinder. So this would be what we consider a standard practice or like the original practice. And this can be up to, when we timed it yesterday, it was about 1:30 per tile. So on a large roof, you know, you could be looking at hundreds of roof hooks. This can take quite a while. And then if you consider the transportation of the tile, or do you take the tool up onto the roof and work up there? This all sort of can lead up to quite a bit of work and can take quite a lot of time and can be the majority of your project in some cases. So today we wanted to discuss this in a little bit of detail, but also introduce this tool that Marcel has, which hopefully will make it a little bit easier and a little bit quicker. So I'll now hand over to Marcel, and he can introduce the product that he has, and if you guys have any questions about that, feel free to ask. We'll be happy to answer them.
Okay. As I said, I'm from the Rabit Bitron Diamanttechnik company, located on the border of the Black Forest, southeast of Germany, 20-minute ride to K2 systems. So yeah, that's how we got connected. Rabit Bitron delivers systems and devices and machines for roof construction. We're focusing on carbide tools, devices, and fixtures for dust-free sawing and drilling of stone and insulation materials. So as Karen showed us, the common process of making the extraction on a tile, we thought about how could we get this faster, and we developed the tile and gutter support milling machine. We got it optionally as a mains powered or a battery powered tool. The mains powered version has a 1010 watts drive motor. The battery powered version is equipped with a 28 volts and 5 amps lithium ion battery. So this is the tool. And we also deliver the milling discs for clay and ceramic tiles, concrete tiles, and wood. The milling depth is from 0 to 20 millimeters, which I don't know what it is in inch, but who cares? And it's continuously adjustable. And the milling width is at the moment 32 millimeters, and further widths are in development.
So it's, as I said, it's a really fast tool that you can work with. It's safe and handy to use. And we deliver it with a transparent storage case. So now we switch over to the next camera. This is camera 3, I guess. I'll stop the presentation. Switch over to 3. And I'll start with the mains powered version. So as you can see, it's mains powered because it's got a cable. And this is the tool. You got the milling disc in here, which is for the clay tile, the diamond version. You can adjust the depth from 0 to 20 millimeters. And you can also plug in a, what is it, vacuumizer? Vacuum cleaner. You should take not your vacuum cleaner from home. Use an industrial version. That's way much better. And yeah, that's the main thing about the tool. We also have it in the battery powered version, which I can show you. Same thing. But in here, we got a segmented disc, like you can use it for the concrete stones. Yeah. But it's the same, and you have that battery. We deliver it with 2 batteries and a device to load it and the machine. But the discs you have to order separately. I'll show you the disc in detail. Like this is the disc for the clay tiles, the width of 32 millimeters, which fits the most hooks. And as I told you before, or I said before, it is in development to get wider discs, because as you probably would then have to do 2 cuts, which is at the moment the state, but we are in development to deliver other width. Same goes here for the segmented version, for the concrete tiles. And yeah. That's how it looks. It's a little bit dirty because we already used it in the morning, but you get it. And for those of you who want to cut wood, because there's, as you may have recognized, there's the part of gutter support in the name of the product. If you want to make fittings for the cutter support, you can order this disc, and it's got those knives, and you can mill wood with it. Just one straight cut and set the gutter support. Okay, that's most of the presentation from now, but as you've seen, the co-worker of Karen, Rainer, needed 1:30 yesterday.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna show you how long I will take to do the. Oh no, Karen's.
Yeah.
I'm going to moderate as we are setting up.
And Marcel, you deliver like throughout Europe?
If you order worldwide, we ship worldwide.
Okay, yeah.
But our main market is Germany or the DACH countries, as call it. but we deliver worldwide.
Yeah, okay.
If somebody orders. We are trying to get some distributors. So if you are a distributor, get in touch with us.
Yeah.
And we can. Should we do the marking of the tile? No. No, we don't do that.
Okay, so Marcel's just going to pop outside. Just be back to grab some tiles as well. So you'll see this in more detail, but he will just be milling. He'll be milling a standard clay tile and a standard concrete tile. We might go into a bit of detail about the differences later on once he's done, but just to show you how it works and how easy it is to work. We'll do a quick demonstration.
While we're waiting, Karen?
Yeah.
While we're waiting, I just want to mention something. If you feel interested to know more about this product, you can always contact us as K2 as well to get more details, to get the contact of Marcel, or just to get the company, right? Is that right, Karen?
Yeah, absolutely. We'll be sending out an email tomorrow or later after this webinar, with all the information of the products that we're discussing here, but also of the products that Marcel has been discussing. And we might be able to put that in the chat shortly as well.
Okay, cool. So if everyone has been in webinars before, you see this is a whole different new webinar today. It's a whole new experience for us as well, because now we are going outside.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. So just before they are finished or ready to run, we'll change over to a different camera and take it outside. And hopefully, and I think we had a webinar in German earlier today, and it all ran pretty well. So hopefully they are ready to go. Tilman, how is 1 second?
One more second, okay.
I feel like we forgot to do the poll this morning, Roman, or earlier.
Yes, I'm still waiting for this. Do you think we should run the poll right now or later on?
Nah, I think we just avoid it for today.
All right.
Apologies for everyone, a bit chaotic today.
That's true.
But also just some information. If you have been tuning into every week for a new webinar, we're actually going to have a bit of a summer pause. So this will be our last webinar for, I think, 4 or 5 weeks. Next one will be in September. So just if you we're looking forward to next week's webinar, which I'm sure you all were. I'm sorry, but you'll have to wait a few weeks. Well, we'll have something special for you after that.
So while we're still waiting, are there maybe some questions? Right now would be a good time to ask any questions. If you have any questions about this tool, about the company, about anything, or even about the Tile Roof webinar itself, feel free to ask us. Right now is the time.
Yeah, if there's something specifically you've been wanting to ask, or you're like, they might cover it, sure we do cover it later on. We good, Tomlin? So I think we're about to change over now. Yeah, so that was the clay tile, and for the concrete tile, the other tool piece will be required. So this was the one that was just shown a moment ago. And then, so Marcel.
So, wait a second.
Hook. So now we have a hook that one of the K2 hooks that we would be using, or we do use. We can then place that with the tile and just show how it sits.
So,
pretty warm out there, is it?
We need that camera here. Maybe we should zoom a little bit in. So this is the result. And the hook.
So it seems like there's no tone right now. We cannot hear anyone.
Oh, I'm muted.
What about now?
Yes, now you're unmuted again.
Oh, okay.
Can you please repeat what you just explained?
So on the clay tile, as you have seen it, the hook fitted perfectly on the upper side and on the lower side of the tile. And the same goes with the concrete tiles. Yeah, just the detail.
And so we just saw you do both the top and the bottom of the clay tile, but only the bottom of the concrete tile. And so that is the process for all
concrete tiles.
Yeah.
Because on the upper side, you don't have to mill. Should I go here? Maybe you see it like that. You would mount the hook this, and you only have to mill the lower side of the tile. I don't know what the name is of that.
The ridge, perhaps the water line. So thank you very much for that demonstration, Marcel. Were there any questions, Roman, about the perhaps that we can? I know, sorry. So Marcel will be here for a couple of minutes now.
Yeah.
So maybe you can answer any questions about the product specifically. I saw we had one question before about tiles in general. So I think Roman and I can answer that one later. But so if there are any questions.
There is one more. Sorry for interrupting you before Marcel is leaving the webinar. It's especially about the tool. There's one person, I think he's called Trevor. He missed the first few minutes, and he's asking about the dust. So can you please show the tool again? What are you going to do about the dust, which is going to be created once you start milling?
About about the
dust.
So you can plug in industrial vacuum machine or vacuum
machine vacuum
cleaner. Yeah, and then you the dust.
Okay, very good. And there's another question. How much does it weigh, including the roof table? Not quite sure what Malcolm means with roof table, but probably the table where you work on the tiles. So how much does it weigh? Maybe you can answer the tool, the question about the tool. How much does the tool weigh?
What is really, the, what is the mass?
I don't know. Really, I don't know.
Or I think a two-handed, less than 5 kilos.
Less, way less, yeah. I think.
Way less than 5 kilos, but, okay. Mm-hmm. But there is probably a data sheet, isn't it?
Yeah, we have it, but I don't have it here.
Okay.
So Malcolm, if you're interested about the tool and if you're even more interested about how much does it weigh, we can easily, you can have the, you can send a request about the data sheet and we can just send it to you.
Okay. I'll put it in the chat.
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay, and then we have one more question from Christian. Hi, is the adapter available on its own or only with the grinder?
The mill, is that by the adapter? So
no, it's only a complete tool.
Yeah, so only a complete tool. However, you, I'm assuming you could buy extra?
Yeah,
or?
You can buy the disc, or you have to buy the disc separately.
Okay.
Because you get the tool and you buy the discs. So maybe you only working with clay tiles, you won't need the concrete disc.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So but usually one... you would order both and
grinders always include the stone. You can't buy the head.
No, you can't buy the head without a grinder. It's always the complete tool.
Okay. Yeah. So I think that's what the Christian wanted to know. Okay, I think that's about it with the questions about the grinder. I'm pretty sure, Karen, we can move on.
Yeah.
And there's one more question. It's just a general question. Karen, you want to answer the question right away?
About the tiles?
Exactly. About the waterproof part.
Yeah.
So the question, sorry, I'm going to ask the question first so everyone knows. Shirin was asking about... how does it ensure that it's still waterproof once you grind the tiles? That's at least how I understand the question. Please correct me, Shivin, if I'm wrong. Karen, can you please explain?
Yeah, so this is another sample we have. We had this one this morning, and tiles like will always overlap. And so depending on the like the batten spacing or the spacing between these points here and the tile length, there will always be sort of some form of overlap. So Tillman could, no, here, sorry.
Yeah.
Which one? Yeah, yeah. So it, hopefully you'll have, your tiles will align with the battens well, is a good sign of any good installation. And the fact that we are milling a small gap on the top and the bottom this gap should lead to the hook fitting snugly in this gap. So there is no seal per se, there's no waterproofing. However, the fact that there's only a very small gap here and that the roof is on an angle, so that all the water is running down, means that if there is any water seepage, it will be minimal. So there is no way to guarantee it, unfortunately. However, it's something that we, so like we have products that we send out all the time. It's something that we haven't come across with people coming back to us saying, our roof's now all wet or it's leaking due to the installation of these tiles. So I'm not saying it's never a problem. However, it's just something that is very rare if it does become an issue.
Also, just one little remark to this. It always depends on the roof tilt as well. So the tiles are not there for just sealing the roof. There's always a fold below that. And also, if you have a tile roof, the roof should be usually around 20, 25, 30 degrees tilt. And then the water is not going to run up. So usually it shouldn't be a problem. And if a little bit of water is coming in, there is a foil which securing that there's no water coming into the ceiling as well.
Yeah.
Just as a little update for this.
Yeah. Thanks for that, Roman. And yeah, so obviously, like if you have a high storm and your tiles are coming off, there's obviously going to be issues there, but that's a greater problem with the roof and not necessarily the roof hooks. So yeah, so hopefully everyone has enjoyed that. It was just something a little bit different we had. This company is just down the road actually from here in Renion. But we are going to go through a few more of the K2 products. And so how, following the process that you've just seen, how do we install the products I have behind me? What products do we have? And go through that in a little bit of more detail. So we'll kind of just do that now. Quickly, you're not going to go into too much detail on the the finer detail. So hopefully you're all aware difference between a solid rail and a single rail. On top here, perhaps we can get a bit of a close up on one of them, Tillman. Just one of the top ones. Yeah, thank you. So solid rail is a product we use where fixation is from underneath. Our modules can then be clamped on top using our either K2 or our standard clamps with the K2 nut or the one mid one ends. In the main difference between that and the single rail, Tillman, could we just have a look at the single rail here? Is that fixation is from the side or from, in this case, on top, which makes installation a lot easier, a lot quicker. So depending on the cost of your project, one of the two rails might be more preferable. The single rail costs a little bit more, the geometry is a little more complex. However, installation time is quicker. Comparing that to the solid rail, a little bit cheaper. However, because you have to come from underneath and work from underneath, installation can be a lot longer. And so it just depends on which part of the project is making up the most cost. Might determine which rail system you're interested in using. So here we have a bit of a small scale setup of a roof, or the support structure of a roof. So we have the rafters, what I would call running in the direction of the tiles effectively. And then the tiles here will sit on the battens and come over here. So the roof hooks, maybe up here, it always has to sit on the rafters. These are the main supporting parts of the roof, the strongest parts. And so it's a lot safer to install on this. And these are usually a lot thicker. So the information that you need when installing a roof is mostly to do with these wooden parts here, all that you can see. The distance between, Tom, if you zoom out just a tad. So the distance between here and here, distance between the rafters, this is very important. The thickness of the rafters, because you need to know where, or if you're able to screw into it, if the rafters are too thin, you might have problems with the placement of the screws. The thickness of the rafters as well, you don't want to screw through them entirely, you just want to screw into them. The thickness of the battens here, so these play an important part with the roof hooks. So tell me, could we just go up to here? So the thickness of the batten plays an important part of this height underneath here. So this is one of the Vario 1 hook that we have with a fixed height here. However, if you have multiple projects with different heights, we have different hook options that are able to accommodate for like a range of widths, range of depths. Maybe we can show that now as well.
Tyrone, I'm very sorry to interrupt, but that was just the perfect opinion to show or to answer the question. Godfrey was asking, why are there so many holes in the roof hook? But we only ever use two of them. Can you please explain? That's the perfect opinion right now.
Yeah, so this is probably the best one to show because it has even more than some of the other ones. And we'll just swap change back to here. And Tilman, maybe if we could just go to about here. So the roof hook, like the materials of the roof hook are quite, well, very firm. So in this case here, there is the option of screwing the roof hook into here. Perhaps you could screw the roof hook into here. Perhaps you could move it. So there's a bit of a couple of options as to where you can screw the roof into the roof hook into the batten. And this is important because the position of the hook relative to the tile is very important. If the tile's sitting like this, you need to screw on the side. However, perhaps the tile is sitting like this, then you might need to screw over this side. So there is a bit of flexibility. So you can align the roof hook with the tile location because you don't want to go back and have to change the whole like roof tile. You don't want to take off every roof tile just to realign one or two hooks. So it's a lot easier to realign the roof hooks. And so this example that we just showed is one option to do that. But we also have slightly other products or a slightly different product, a different style of product. Which allows for a bit more flexibility. So instead of having what was the other one, 10 holes or 8 holes here on the, this is suitable for our cross hook four. It's just one standard base plate. And then there is a flexibility to slide the hook to different positions along the batten. So perhaps the roof hook needs to sit here due to the tile location, but perhaps it also needs to sit here instead of the tile location. And you just have that little bit of flexibility. And here you can set the base plate onto this side, or perhaps you could set it onto the other side as well, just depending on where the tiles sit. Perhaps this isn't even enough of an option though. Perhaps your tile might sit somewhere even further out. And we have solutions for this as well, where the crossboard, which actually sits between this rafter and this rafter, and then you're able to put the roof hook at any position between two rafters. So this is something that is great for perhaps the edge of the roof, or perhaps when you have obstacles or other cases where maybe it's a non-standard roof.
Maybe we should show the sample. It's like this. We should explain what crossbar is or
similar. So we have two slightly different products.
Is that what you mean? We have both, and it's 2 meters pieces.
Yeah. Okay. So maybe we just do it on here. This is what we consider the base plate, the standard base plate, with either a single board or three different heights. And so these cross boards that I'm talking about come in lengths of up to 2.1 meters, and they're able to be cut on site to fit between the battens that require. So in case of an emergency where you just have one batten length wasn't quite as expected, or perhaps there's a window that you weren't quite sure what was going to happen underneath the tiles, it's always a good idea to have maybe a couple of the crossboards just in the back of your car or on site or in stock somewhere floating around. So for the 90% of the cases or 99% of the cases, these will work, but just in case, the longer version is always an option. Roman, I got a bit off track with that, but I feel I answered the question.
Sorry for interrupting, yes, but you were answering the question quite well, so thank you for that.
That's okay. Were there any other questions in relation to hook placement, perhaps, that we could?
Well, while you were already showing the base plate right now, what would you do if the buttons are much thicker than this one and the roof hook wouldn't fit behind it? Is it a good practice to use spacers or packers behind the roof hook before screwing down? That's the question of Malcolm again.
Okay, so just to go a bit further for perhaps the people listening, if they didn't quite catch that, if we have a thicker, if this piece of wood here is thicker, we need to get higher, like we need to get higher away from the tile, because the tile will also sit here coming down. How do we get this board or the roof hook itself off the roof or away from the roof? So we have two options. Tillman, could we just come to this? Maybe we can undo that. Yeah, so we have a, I need to know. Yeah, so in the comment about the packers, Roman, thanks for that question. So we do have a product in the, which you can buy in the stock lists, that you can buy, that is effectively that. It just sits under the base plate of the hook, and effectively lifts the base plate up a little bit, and then gives you more space with the roof hook. There is also different hooks that provide different heights, and so here. Probably have the wrong tool for this one as well. Hopefully you can see the, No, I think this one works. So hopefully you can see in here, Tommy, can you just zoom in? So we have the option of raising this up and down. So this is the, here we have the Vario 1, single hook, and there's the option of lowering this to get closer to the roof, or pulling it up to get a higher gap underneath the roof hook. So if you have really thick battens or you have really thick tiles, you can extend this up through the hook selection, but you can also put these packers in underneath the base plate. And the packers will effectively bring it up. The packers are a little more tedious, we would say, like they are definitely usable. However, there is a limit to how far you can come up, because you're putting more stress on the screws and the further you get away from the wood. So there's no sort of hard and fast rule, I'm sorry, as to terms of how many packers or if you can use packers, but it is definitely something you can do.
All right. Thank you, Karen. Thanks for answering this question.
And then while we're here, then we could probably just have a look at the. So here we have the single rail. So this is just the side profile. As I said, fixation is from the side. This rail comes in different sizes, different strengths. So if you have a much larger distance between two battens, perhaps you need a stronger rail. If you have quite high snow loads or quite high wind loads, you might need a stronger rail as well. So just to give you an idea of what products we have, these are the comparison between the single rail 36 and the single rail 50. So these are also the same idea is for the solid rail as well. So if you are using a solid rail system and you think I need a thicker rail, then There are sticker rails suitable for that as well. So rails, tile thickness for underneath the, let's go back to this one, tile thickness for underneath the hook, and batten thickness is also an issue, but what about the thickness of the tile? Can we go up a bit, Tillman? Have a look at this one. The thickness of the tile that sits above the roof hook. So we have different solutions or different tiles for this option as well. So here we have a cross hook 4. And just to show you a bit more here, we'll come close. Whoa, excuse me. So we have 4 fixation points or 4 variant points. The 4th being this point in here. So we can loosen this with a hex key, and then raise this place up a little bit or bring it down, depending on how much space you want between the tile that sits in here. So this is a really good option for perhaps you have really old roofs or roofs that are a little bit uneven and the battens aren't quite flat. You can install all the roof hooks in the same position, and you're quite confident that if you do need to raise or lower part of it, you can just adjust it here at the end. So this is probably the last point of flexibility. There's the points within here as well to change underneath, and also the points in here to change this depth between the top and the bottom of the roof hook. I think that's a quick covering of some of the products we have. We haven't gone into everything in detail there. Roman, before I pass over to you, I think I got a little bit sidetracked in what I was talking about. So was there anything you think I missed or we could go over, or is there any questions that we can answer while we're here?
I think right now everything is clear. Nothing you missed, and what I think about at least. No, I think we're good. Questions are, maybe there's one more question coming in right now.
Oh, someone with
a question with about the finger rail. We would love to the ability of to use. Okay, this is something like a special question. I think we have to write that one down. We have to answer this question, but please again ask the questions in the Q&A section so we can actually answer them in there as well. But other than that, nothing to say, no question to answer right now, right live here, Kyren. I think we can move on with the online part then.
Okay. I'll pass
Thank
over
you
to
very you. Much. Thank you very much. And you'll stay there, answer some questions, and I'll continue, right?
Yeah, that sounds good.
All right, then. So,
thank you.
So, hi, everyone, again. Now we continue with the online part. And today we are skipping the part with our website and jump right directly into our planning tool, into K2Base. And that we can do this, I have to obviously share my screen, and that I'll do right now. So here we go. You must be able to see my screen now. I already started planning a little roof somewhere in the Nordics, in Stockholm actually, and we pretend that this is a tile roof. Just a little basics for those of you who haven't planned with K2Base anything yet, there are little tutorials which you find right here. They're on YouTube, and it's just like 5-minute clips, maybe sometimes even 2 or 3 minutes, and they help a lot if you haven't worked with K2Base. It's actually very simple and easy to use, but sometimes it can be a little bit confusing. And then the easiest way to help yourself is just watch these little tutorials. Other than that, what I have to say is, if you still don't know how to continue and you have somehow trouble and want to contact us, please download the file right here on the download button and send it to us. Then you can ask the questions and we are able to have a look into your project. Because if you don't send it, it's just in your, it's an online program and it's just in your online account. So we cannot access it. That's why you have to download it, send it to us, and then we can have a look at it. So that was it about the like the main parts about K2 Base. Now we continue to go a bit deeper into detail. So we choose an address, which we have here in Stockholm right now today. And you can name the project, what we did today as a webinar with the tile roof and so on with the author and who is your customer and what's the contact. You can just sign all that in if you want to, but you don't have to. What I want to show now and want to go deeper into detail is about the roof section. Kyron was just explaining on the actual part with the rafter and the buttons that there are different heights, thicknesses, distances, and that's what we need for our planning as well. If you don't have these measurements, if you don't have these values, there can be sometimes mistakes happen with K2 Base as well. Sometimes you can have the wrong roof hook for the wrong tiles or for the whole wrong roof. So, or just do some mistakes with the planning. So please make sure you type in the right values and you get all the measurements. So we are here, I hope you can see my screen, and we are here on the roof section in K2 Base right now, which is the second section. And we can start drawing a roof by clicking the plus right here, and then just draw the roof, choose between the 2D view or the satellite view, which we can change right here, delete the roof, rename the roof, and so on. So we keep it with the 2D view now to make it simple. Half our length and width of the roof, we signed that one in with 9 meters and 32 meters today, but then we come to the even more specific and more important values, just like the building height. It's very important because the wind loads, they change from the different heights. So if you're above 8 meters, for example, you have higher wind loads than 6 or 7 or 8 meters. If you're higher than 10 or 12 meters, for example, 15 or 18 meters, there are also different values. There's a different calculation implemented into K2 Base. So please make sure you know what's the height of the building you're planning at. That makes a big difference if you have the height, or it can make a big difference. Second thing, which is very important, is the roof pitch, because also this is very important, for example, the snow load. If you have a very high roof pitch, for example, 30, 35 or 40 degrees, snow will fall down. If you only have 10 degrees, snow will put more pressure onto the modules. And all this, that's just an example, that's all in the calculation. It's all implemented in K2 Base. And if you, for example, have a roof pitch of 35 or 40 degrees, but you type in 10 degrees, you will get way more roof hooks and therefore it will be much more expensive. So please make sure type in the right values. Next thing, what we can type in K2 Base, or what we have to type in, is if it's a tile trapezoidal, this is the actual roof covering, but I'm pretty sure everyone is doing that one right. And then once you chose one of the roof coverings, you are able to type in the actual parameters for the certain roof. So if we type in it's a tile roof, a gable roof, for example, we have to type in the rafter spacing. Rafter spacing is important. If you are, for example, you have a rafter spacing of 0.6, then you might be able to get on every second rafter a roof hook. If you have a rafter spacing of, for example, 0.8, then sometimes it's not enough anymore to go on every second rafter, and therefore we have to go on every rafter and we'll have more roof hooks. So also with this value, please make sure to measure it out, have the right value in here. Next thing would be the rafter width. Kyron was just showing one rafter, which was also, I think, just around about 80 millimeters. So you saw that some of the base plates were already really narrow. And then obviously if you have the right rafter width, sometimes some roof hooks are better than the other ones. So if you have this value, also please make sure to type in the right one. And then the last very important is the button spacing. Chiron was just showing, and maybe he can show again later, that the tiles, they're overlapping. And the distance between the rafter, between the button, I'm sorry, they are making also the overlapping part. So if you have the button spacing closer together, the more the tiles are overlapping each other, and the more you have to use the angle grinder, or you are able to use a whole different roof hook, which has a longer, call it roof hook finger, and it's going longer out and you have to grind a little less. So all these values, as you see, which I have just explained, are very, very useful and actually very important to type in with the right measurements, the right values. That's actually all about the roof section.
Roman, just before
are there any questions before I continue?
Just before you move on, Roman, there was someone, yes. Yosef has asked a question about the roof orientation. So there's an option there, roof pitch orientation. And so I know the white arrow there plays a role. So is that representing like down or up, or how do I change that to a different roof, a different direction?
The white arrow is always facing down sliding. So always down the roof. And once you are drawing the roof and typing in the roof pitch, you can see in the satellite view, the white little arrow pointing down the roof. But if you, for example, drew the roof on the wrong side, like let's say we change it to this side here, now we would have it on the wrong side and we want to change that one. And we have the option to change it while clicking here on the roof orientation. But we can only turn the roof or the roof orientation always just 90 degrees. So for example, I'm doing one click now on this arrow, and now the roof would be facing down south. One more click and now it's facing east. So this is how we can change the roof orientation. Karen?
Thanks for that, Roman.
That's the answer? Okay, yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you for the question. I totally forgot about this one. Okay, so we have the roof now. Through the roof, we have explained all about the values, which are important. So now we do a little planning, I would say. We continue. We have the option of an obstruction on the roof, a little obstacle, just like a chimney or a light band or whatever you have. You are able to draw that if you want to. And also in this section, you can just write a remark about the roof if you have assumed values, for example, or some special stuff you want to write down about the roof. The next step for planning would be choosing a module, and we have a database which with all the different manufacturers which are on the market right now. And as you see, you can just scroll down and find any of the manufacturers. So If you find a module which is not in here or a module manufacturer, please contact us and we'll forward it, because it's not from us. We download this database into K2Base from also another company, as I know. So today we are choosing just the Trina module, which is already inside here. It's a regular size from right now. As you all know, the modules got a little bit bigger, but this is still, I would say, a regular size. We continue and with the next step. So we're still on the design, but with the next step here, we choose the different hooks which we can use or which we want to use by using the rail. So if we want to use the solid rail, we have to know that upfront. If we want to use the solid rail, we have to use a solid hook. If we want to use the single rail, we have to use a single hook, or even the insertion system. So this is what we choose right up here. If we know already, we know we wanna use the single rail system, we click on the single rail system, and at the end, you only have options to choose between the different single rail roof hooks. Don't worry if you make a mistake up front here, you are always able to change that, and I will show you how. So one click on the single rail, only possible, it's not only possible, but it's always better to draw your own module array, not complete roof, because then you can change much more. Only possible to do to blend a parallel to the roof, but we have the option between portrait and landscape orientation. So for now, we just keep it regular, one layer system, we want to go portrait, click the add button and start by clicking once and twice our module field. This is our module field now. We have 10 by 3 modules and we have all what we just clicked on right listed on the left-hand side here. So we use the single rail system, portrait orientation, the distance on the short side, there has to be a distance and you can change it a bit longer or shorter the way you want it, but it has to be a little distance. And then we are able to change the clamps, the module clamps, just like the one mid, which are, and one end, which are the universal clamps or the regular extra small clamps, the XS. And then the last thing we can change is the color of the module clamps. So if you have black module frames, it just makes sense to use the black clamps as well because it looks much nicer. Next step would be the loads. And each country, this is very important to know, each country looks different. You always have the map of the country and then the different areas. And then you have to see first, what are the wind loads and the snow loads? So you have the two different options and the two different colors. Right now, we are in the wind load zone, which is blue. You see all the different blue types, but once I click to the snow, you see everything will change into green. So we have the different areas with different values, which are right in here. We have already typed in the wind, the basic wind speed, which is 24 meters per second, and the snow load 2.0, because we're in the Stockholm area right here. So this is how we define the loads, pretty much all implemented with the right address. So please make sure you type in the right address before you start planning, because afterwards, if you change the address, your whole planning, the whole roof will be gone. So once we have done this, we are already at the result page and we have a nice overview on our whole roof, with the planning, with the whole module field, and also our fastener and rails. If we like, we can just change and make them see, or can let us see whatever we want to see. For example, if we want to have a more clear look in onto the rails, we can just erase right here the modules and we have it more clear. Okay, these are the in blue, these are the rails for our modules. Or you see here different colors, hopefully you see them. The yellow part, which is the side area, then we have the red part is the corner area and the center area of the roof. So we can also show and hide these roof areas. But this is not the most important. Right now we are more into the roof hooks, and as we chose the single rail before, so our rail is a single rail, we have the option to choose from the different fastener, which only fit for the single rail system, by clicking on this little arrow. And there we have all the different roof hooks. I think that's about it. You have the summary. You can download the generate the report, which is also the static report in the same time. Please make sure that this screen tickets right here with written everything is in order, and to make sure everything works out. And then you can download, if you like to order it, you can download the bill of materials just as an Excel list. There's an Excel export right here, just like downloading the PDF report, downloading the whole project, if you like to save it somewhere else or to send it to some customer of yours. Are there any questions for the base calculation, Karen?
There was one question in regards to the wind map. And so it was another one from Josef. So thanks for that, Josef. But it was regarding to other countries. So I'm assuming he works in the Czech Republic.
Okay.
And so at the moment, like I've just opened up a project in the background, and the Czech Republic is one of the countries where this is not preset.
Okay.
I know our development team is always looking to implement more countries, and the majority of Europe, I think, is now input into base. So if you were to plan in Spain, for example, or I think a few weeks ago you did one in France.
I did one in France. I did one in Belgium or in Spain. And it just looks always different. You see the map usually, you have the values, but you always have to type them in manually most of the time. There are some times which is nothing implemented and you have to type in everything manually, but then you have the option to change right here from zone to manually, or you don't even have the option to put the zone in.
Yeah, so I think in the Czech Republic at the moment, it's all manual, but this is something we are working on, like constantly putting in new countries. And so hopefully this will be something that will be there and throughout the rest of Europe shortly.
And as we know this now, we can always mention it at the base team. Thanks for reminding us. Okay, Karen, I think that was about it from my side. If there are no more questions about base, I would say let's start the Q&A round. Do you have anything to add?
We had one that was more of a comment, or it was a question about the rail locations for solid, portrait or landscape. And I don't know, Tillman, could I just get some camera, change of camera? And so with the tile roofs, generally speaking, because the hooks are located on the supports, on the rafters, if you want to put in a module that sits in this direction, like a landscape module effectively, you're going to need a cross bracing system. So rail running this way and one rail running this way. And that's because the distance between here and here it's unlikely that this will be the same as this clamping position of the module. So each module has a standard or a acceptable clamping position, which is between a sort of a quarter and a third of the way in from the edge. And you'll be lucky if you have the same distance here and here than you do with the module. So there's a question from Trevor about rotating the single rail to run the other way. And because for maybe 2% of the time, that would be suitable. We don't have this as a solution, and it's not something that we'll probably be looking into. So if you're lucky enough that happens, that this spacing is the same, I'm sorry that you're unlucky, because you would still have to do cross bracing regardless of that. So I just thought it was quite a specific question, but subtle differences with the material that you have or the building that you have can determine the material you need to put the modules on the roof as well. So it's probably more of something you just get used to, but not something you look at straight away and go, oh yeah, of course that means this and this. So Roman, were there some other questions as well?
We want Hungary. Just about the same question about the wind map about Hungary. It's just about the same, I guess, than Czech Republic. Probably they are working about implementing it. Not quite sure when it comes, but we will forward the request for sure. We promise.
Yeah, and that's something that's really good about these webinars. If there's anything that the viewers, participants, you guys would like to see in base, it's a good opportunity to say, hey, what about this, or what about this, or when is this coming? Because we can give that feedback directly to the people that implements it. So we appreciate the comments, even if they're not necessarily questions about them. The feedback is good in any form.
All right. So right now we have the opportunity to turn on the microphone. If someone wants to ask directly a question to us, so just raise your virtual hand, so we can unmute you. Karen, do you see anyone? Any questions? Seems like everything. Oh, yeah, Trevor wants to talk.
Right. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Great. I don't necessarily need to steal everybody's time with my question about the solid rail and the single rail. If you want to, we can take it up in a separate discussion on the side. We are aware that it's very unlikely that the hook and the rail would land exactly where the clamping position for the module would be. The feedback we're getting from our customers is that they're not really big fans of the cross rail system. Our installers love the cross rail system because they can easily walk on the roof and have a lot of support. It's a much more stable system, but the customers think that it comes up too high from the roof. So we're trying some different solutions by putting in a board between the battens, sort of like a cross rail or like a cross board, but just made of wood. And then we can have the hooks land where we want. And we are using the solid rail to go in a standing orientation, so we have it, but we can't do that with single rail, which would be a lot more convenient. So that was kind of what my question was about.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks. Yeah. Thanks very much for that, Trevor and Uriah. Maybe it's something we can discuss in more detail offline. I'll put my email address in the chat, and maybe if you send me an email, we can organize a discussion later.
Sure. Yep. Sounds great.
Okay. There was one more question just written about a distributor of us. So if you ever want to know where our distributors are or which one is the closest to you, you can always find them on our website. There's a list if you just click on contact and distributors, and you can just see, okay, the different countries, and then they will show all the different distributors in your country. Okay, Karen, I think if there's nothing else to show from my side, I have to thank everyone for being here, for watching again. And hope to see you in a few weeks. We'll take a little break because it's vacation time and we have a lot to do. Unfortunately, we don't have time off. Or do you, Karen? I don't, at least.
No, no rest for the wicked.
Not lucky enough. The next few weeks, at least.
Yeah.
But anyways, thanks for watching. Thank you for having us. And yeah, Karen, I'd say you answer the rest of the questions and we'll see you later. Yeah. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah, thanks, Roman. So I'll just wrap up here as well and allow a few more moments for if anyone has any more questions. As mentioned, we're having a few weeks off. So I think the next one we have might also be on tile roofs, actually, and it'll be in 5 weeks, mid-September. So if you're interested in that, we will then be having flat roofs, trapezoidal roofs, or trapezoidal roofs into the sub-construction. And then we'll be doing some more webinars on things a little bit different. So a bit like today, where we showed how to do the tiles. We're just looking at a few options as to some more detailed or just some slightly different webinars as well. So thank you very much for everyone who has participated today. We appreciate it. So for myself and Roman, thank you. We have two little helpers over this side, Tillman and Klaus. Oh, and we have Lisa with us today. They're always, they're the ones that make all this happen. So thank you very much to them. And that's about it. If you have some time off over summer, I wish you all the best. And until our next webinar, thank you very much. And good luck with your solar. Thank you. Bye.